Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you have your Bibles, we're reading from the New Living Testament, New Living Translation. Go to chapter 21 and just hold your place there. When you got it, say, I got it.
Where?
Genesis chapter 21. And when you got it, say, I got it. Amen. We got one, got it.
We got everybody's got it.
How hard is it to find the first book of the Bible? Amen. Unless you're not a Christian and you don't know the Bible at all. So, amen. The book of beginnings, Genesis. We've been in the book of Genesis for quite some time. I can't even probably go back and look at when we started the book of Genesis, but we've been on it for probably several months. Am I right, church?
Amen.
Amen. And we have learned something in the book of Genesis. We have been studying the beginnings, the book of beginnings. We've been studying Genesis. What does it mean in the original Greek? It means the origin. It means the original gene pool. Amen. And it's good not only to know what's going to happen in the end, but it's very even more important to know what's going to happen at the beginning, because the book of Genesis is the foundation upon which all 65 other books rest.
Hallelujah.
Amen. The origin of what happened in the garden of with Adam and Eve. Hallelujah. And now we're studying the mighty hero of faith. We're studying Abraham, a man of God, a man after God's heart. Maybe not quite like David, just two different temperaments, two different people in the Bible, but a hero of faith nonetheless. Hallelujah. Everybody there with me on chapter 21.
Yes.
Now, if you're taking notes today, some of you do take notes, and so if you're taking notes, the title is, Will You Trust Him?
Hallelujah.
Will you trust Him? If you're taking notes, I don't know if it's going to be a two-part, a three-part. I'm not quite sure. This chapter is very long, and I didn't want to rush through it. So the Holy Ghost gave me the title of the series, two or three parts, I don't know. Will you trust Him? Hallelujah.
Amen.
The Bible says in Proverbs 3 and 5, trust in the Lord with all thy heart.
Amen.
And lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways.
Yes.
And what will He do? He will direct your path. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I saw in that scripture quite a bit. Because I always need my path directed by the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, we are the sons and daughters of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
How many of you have figured out in this Christian walk that it is not easy to trust the Lord?
Amen.
How many of you know that it's not easy to believe for the impossible when it comes to, especially when we're sick or when something happens, you see something that seems impossible with God? But nothing is impossible with God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's why we come to church. We're called the ecclesia, the called out ones, the assembling together, not forsaking the assembling together as the manner of some have. Why we come to church is not one of the things that we do as Christians. I'm sorry, it's not the only thing we do. It's one of the things we do as Christians to build our faith,
Amen.
To go from faith to faith and from glory to glory.
Amen.
Faith cometh by hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing by the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
Some of us need our faith rebooted every Sunday. Amen. Because
Amen.
We go through things during the week.
Ooh.
Sometimes we go through trials. Sometimes we hit some bumps in the road. But we come here on Sunday and we press in because we're called. Many are called, few are chosen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Abraham and Sarah have been, we know from all the time we've been studying, they've been in a walk of faith. How many of you know that from all the studies we've done? How many of you have felt like going through chapter to chapter and sentence to sentence and scripture to scripture, how many of you have found that helps you understand the book a little better?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We know that Abraham and Sarah have been in a walk of faith for many years, as we have studied. They have hit some trials. They have had some setbacks. They have had some tribulation times. And they even had some sin in the camp, in their own camp, that had not been dealt with. The sin of lying. They had fallen into a pattern of lying when confronted in a situation, or when they found themselves in a situation, they fell into a pattern of lying because Abraham failed to trust God. And the lie was that Sarah is my sister. But he never told the truth that Sarah was his wife.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And they had to deal with that sin because they were waiting on a promise. They were waiting on a miracle, the birth of their son Isaac.
Hallelujah.
And until that sin had been dealt with, God could not move his hand upon that promise for them. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How many know that God is not going to bless men? Amen? Yes, we know that by grace, we know that there's space, as Pastor Jesse always teaches. There's space because we have grace through Jesus Christ. But don't frustrate the grace of God.
Amen.
Even so, you're waiting on a blessing and it hasn't happened, but you haven't quite come out of the mess.
Amen.
You haven't quite come out of or taking the sin maybe out of the camp. I'm not talking about perfection. I'm talking about living a holy life with the help of the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. Jesus says, if I do not go, I cannot send the Comforter. We need the Holy Spirit to walk this walk. Amen.
Amen.
We need the Holy Spirit in our lives today.
Hallelujah.
So let's find out what happened with Abraham and Sarah in Genesis chapter 21. Let's find out about the promise. And now it's finally coming to pass. Amen. Will you trust Him?
Yes, Lord.
Will you trust Him with that situation? Brother Hernandez, will you trust Him with that situation? Sister Hernandez, will you trust Him with that situation?
Amen.
Will you trust Him? Everybody there with me, Genesis chapter 21.
Thank you, Father.
The Lord kept His word. Oh boy, I can't even go too far after that without already having something to say about that. The Lord kept His word and did for Sarah exactly what He had promised. She became pregnant and she gave birth to a son for Abraham in his old age. Let's go with me to Numbers. I have to do an interfacing of scripture for this. Now, how many know when we start flipping around in the Bible, it's called a topical sermon. When we don't flip around and I keep you in one area or we keep you in one area, that's called an exegetical teaching and that's different. So today we're doing a topical sermon because we're going to be going from a few places today. So place to place. Amen?
Amen.
So go with me to Numbers 23, verse 19. And when you're there, just look up or say amen.
Amen.
So the Lord keeps His word. How many know the Bible says the Lord hastens to perform His word in your life?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Numbers 23, verse 19. So we know now that we just read in the opening of chapter 21 that the Lord kept His word. There was a delay. How many know there was 25 years between the time the prophecy of Isaac came and the miracle? 20, can you imagine waiting on a miracle for 25 years? But let me tell you, Abraham was going to bring the Jewish lineage through him. So how many know that God wanted to make sure they were ready? Hallelujah. 23 verse 19, and it goes like this. It says, God is not a man, so He does not lie. King James says, God is not a man that He should lie. So how many know God is not a man?
Hallelujah.
How many know God is not human?
Amen.
How many know that we don't refer to God as our homeboy, man upstairs? As Christians, we don't refer to Him like that.
Amen.
When people refer to Him as daddy, or, you know, and we do hear that, We don't jump holy and try to correct people because that's their understanding. It's the heart that counts. We can discern the heart. Amen?
Amen.
But we refer to Him as Abba, Father.
Amen.
We refer to Him as Adonai. We refer to Him as our El Shaddai. Hallelujah. We refer to Him as the Holy One of Israel.
Amen.
We refer to Him as Jehovah Nisi, the Lord is our banner. We refer to Him as Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is our peace.
Uh-huh.
That's how we reverence the Lord. We don't bring God down to human level. Because He's a spirit. He's not a man.
Amen.
So He's not a man, so He does not lie. So He's not a man. He's not flesh like we. He wasn't born through the seed of man into sin like we were. So He does not lie. So whatever He says in His word from Genesis to Revelation
amen.
Is true.
Amen.
His promises are yes and in Him, amen, to the glory of God through us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
God is not a man, so He does not lie. He is not human, so He does not change His mind. How many know that we change our mind? God does not change
yes.
His mind.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
People change. God says in the book of Hebrews, says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What does that mean, Pastor? Because people take that scripture and go all over the place with it. That means the doctrine and the plan of Jesus Christ and His teachings were from the beginning, and they always will be, which means God's word cannot be changed.
Amen.
The Bible says in the book of Revelation, if we change it, add or take away anything from it, what will happen? We can invite disease and the plagues upon us. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So He's not a man that He should lie. He didn't lie to Sarah. It was just delayed until the proper time. He's not human, so he does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and failed to act? Has he ever spoken something to you and he did not act on it? Well, maybe he hasn't given you an answer yet, but doesn't mean he's not going to act on it. If it's lined up with his word, he will hasten to perform it in your life.
Amen.
The way he did for Sarah and Abraham. So he does not change his mind. Has he ever spoken and failed to act? Has he ever promised and not carried it through? Has he ever promised something to you and not carried it through? His promise. He will carry. I promise to you that I've seen it in my own life. He will bring it to pass. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the book of Habakkuk, it says, write the vision, make it plain on tablets. Though the vision tarry, it will come to pass.
Hallelujah.
Go back with me to Genesis. So we know that what he told Sarah and Abraham, he kept his word. He's going to keep whatever word he's given you, whatever promise he's given you that's lined up with his word and lined up with the call on your life and where you're going in life, he will bring it to pass. He will do it. And he will make it good. Let's go to verse 2. So she became pregnant and she gave birth to a son for Abraham in his old age. This happened at just the time God had said it would. He's never early. He's never late. But he's always on time. We serve an on-time God. Some of us get upset because we don't have our answer, our answers to our prayers by tomorrow morning. We get upset. We get frustrated. Why? Because we are learning to trust the Lord. In those 25 years, you think Abraham and Sarah did not live a perfect Christian life, as we would say today. They went through some stuff. They went through some hard times. They had to learn to live in the wilderness. They had to learn to put the flesh under submission. They had to learn that as long as there was sin in the camp, their blessing was going to be delayed.
Come on.
Amen.
That's good.
So this blessing was right on time. It didn't come when they thought. You know, they had to go and make something happen, and we're going to see the result of that. We may get to that part today, I'm sure, a little bit of it. But we know when we start helping God along, we know that we're going to reap some consequences. Amen.
Amen.
We can make the plans, but God will have the last word.
That's right.
Amen.
So Abraham named, this is, now they have, happened just at the right time. Abraham named their son, everybody say Isaac.
Isaac.
Hallelujah. Finally, Lord. Hallelujah. Isaac. Very important birth. It says 8 days after Isaac was born, Abraham circumcised him as God had commanded.
Hallelujah.
Abraham was 100 years old when Isaac was born. Pastor, am I going to have to wait till I'm 100 to get my blessing? No. How many know that back then, people lived a lot longer than today? Environment, climate, just the time. Everything was different back then. So Abraham's 100 years, maybe like our 50s, maybe, I would say, if you want to do a comparison or a parallel. It was considered older, because you don't hear of a 90-year-old woman having a baby. So, you know, I've heard some wacky things out there. A 78-year-old woman said, I know God's going to give me a baby. He told me I'm going to have a baby. This is a Christian saying this. How many know that for the time, there was something special God was doing with Abraham and Sarah?
That's right.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Remember, the Jewish lineage was coming through Abraham. Hallelujah. Very important. So it's in verse 6. And Sarah declared, God has brought me laughter.
Amen.
All who hear about this will laugh with me. How many know that laughter doeth good like a medicine? A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Sometimes we break down in holy laughter. It's been happening. We had the fasting, and it happened a couple of services in the past. Holy laughter breaks out. How many know that we're laughing because we're already seeing our miracle come to pass?
Hallelujah.
We're laughing because we already know God is already on the throne and he's going to do it. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
We're laughing because we're seeing it before it comes to pass. That's faith.
Amen.
Amen. Faith is the substance of things hoped for now and the evidence of things not seen.
That's right.
We don't see it, but we already believe it. That's how the Christian is supposed to walk. Will you trust him? We used to have a pastor that said, it was just a saying, but it really made a lot of sense scripturally. Faith says God can, trust says God will.
Yes.
Will you trust him? Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
So laughter doeth good like a medicine. We laugh together here. Why do y'all laugh in church? We know this is not good to laugh in church. It's supposed to be serious. How many know that there's times in the Bible where God sits on his throne and he's laughing in his throne?
That's right.
Hallelujah. We laugh in the spirit. We don't force people to laugh holy laughter. But Pastor Jesse may come and give you a touch that the anointing to see if that laughter can fall on you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Or if you receive that laughter. And maybe you're, for a while you're going to have joy in your spirit. You're not going to laugh out loud. But maybe one day you'll just break out in laughter. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
My pastor, a pastor of ours used to say, you haven't had church until mascara is smeared and bobby pins are flying.
Hallelujah.
You haven't had church. That's like the old time Pentecost talk right there. They were old, a lot older than we were. So praise God. So now we know that God has given Abraham a son in his old age. He was 100 years old. Let's go on. And it goes on to say, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse a baby? Who would have ever thought that a 90-year-old woman, can you imagine? People probably thought they're going to have a baby at 90. I don't think so. Have people ever made fun of you when you say, God's going to do something for me, and they don't believe it? It's like, well, I did that for you. And they laugh at you and they make fun of you as a Christian. But let me tell you, God, it will do. And you know what? Sometimes he'll even do it just to show that person, hey, that they serve a true living God. They serve me. Hallelujah.
Yes,
so we can give him glory.
That's
and
right.
Be a witness to those who are without. Goes on to say, so who would have said Abraham and Sarah would nurse a baby? Yet I have given Abraham a son in his old age. You know, the Bible says in Proverbs 13 and 12, it says, hope deferred maketh the heart sick, but when the answer comes, it is a tree of life. Some of our blessings and promises are on deferred. They're on deferred mode. But when the answer comes, and it makes us sick because we're like, oh, Lord, when is this going to happen? Oh, Lord, you said it was going to... Oh, Lord, when is this going to happen? Oh, Lord, you said this was going to take place. You said, Lord, you said, hope deferred maketh the heart sick. Sometimes we get sick in our heart, right? Because we haven't got our answer.
Amen.
But when the answer comes, it's a tree of life. Woo! Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody turn with me to Luke chapter 1. We're going to study about another promise that came to pass that seemed so impossible, so unlikely. There was no way this could happen. So Luke, let's go to Luke chapter 1, starting at verse 35. Topical sermon. We're doing the little Bible drill. Moving from place to place today. I don't often have y'all do that when I'm teaching a book in a chronological way. But today, the Holy Spirit just led me to do this because he wanted me to show you there were other times in the Bible where God spoke and there was just no way. It just seemed impossible. And people around them didn't believe. But look at this story. This is a great example. This is the Holy Ghost or the angel speaking to Mary, the mother of Jesus. Mary asked the angel, but how can this happen? This is Luke 1, verse 34, if you're not with me. I'll start at 34 and we'll go on from there to 38. Mary asked the angel, but how can this happen? I am a virgin. How can I have a baby if I'm a virgin? How is it supposed to happen? Verse 35, the angel replied, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. This is a promise to Mary that she is going to have the Son of God. Even though she's going to be a virgin, she's going to conceive a child by the way of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
This is a miracle. This is a miracle. A teenage young girl. Look at what... the Lord spoke to Abraham and Sarah. You're going to have a child when you're 90 and you're going to be 100, Abraham. Are you kidding me? That's why she laughed in her tent. Remember several chapters back?
That's right.
Hallelujah. So they tell her, he's going to be called the Son of God. Verse 36. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. She's going to be birthing who?
John
the Baptist. Amen. People used to say she was barren. But she has conceived a son and is now in her 6th month. John the Baptist was Jesus' cousin, and he was also 6 months older. For nothing is impossible with God. Nothing is impossible with God. How many of you have seen miracles even in your own life?
Amen.
And you have said, look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. We've seen that song. I'm going to bring that song back. I don't know why we haven't.
Amen.
He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. Oh, We need some of that sometimes. Hallelujah. I got to find that song. I don't know if we have it in our folder or not, but I got to find that song. It's an anointed song. So nothing is impossible with God. We sing about the glory of God. We sing about the promises. Will you trust Him? Will you trust Him 25 years? Oh, Pastor, that's a long time for me to be waiting on my miracle. But you know what? The Lord is never late. He's never early. He will be on time. It is for a point in time. Even though it tarry, it will come to pass.
Come on,
everybody go back with me to Genesis. Genesis. Go back to the chapter 21. Hallelujah. So now the story goes on to say, verse 8, everybody, when you're there, just look up so I know you're there. Oh, amen. Well, that was nice. Everybody at the same time. Okay, verse 8. When Isaac grew up and was about to be weaned, Abraham prepared a huge feast to celebrate the occasion. So it looks like Isaac was a little older. Doesn't say here, but when you study in commentaries, it was right after the weaning period. The weaning period in this culture at this time between 4 and 9 years old. So let's say 4-ish, maybe going on 5, somewhere around there. So that's what the scripture meant by saying grow up. It was after toddler years. So I guess it was about his age over here, Santiago's age. So when Isaac grew up and was about to be weaned, Abraham prepared a huge feast to celebrate the occasion. But Sarah saw Ishmael, the son of Abraham, and her Egyptian servant Hagar making fun of her son Isaac. Can you imagine sitting there as a mom and someone making fun of your child who's around this age? How do you think that would make you feel? Mm-hmm. I'm telling you, that wasn't the first feeling that Sarah got. She's been going through this for, I think, Ishmael was probably about his late teens, maybe 17, 18 years old. So he's way older, and he's got his mother, and he's making fun of a 4 or 5 year old little boy. Sarah was not happy. She was upset. She had probably been going through this for a long time, and finally she had had enough. How many of you know that when her and Abraham made that decision to get ahead of God, make a decision to have that son through Hagar, even though God forgave them and God's still going to bless them, they are still reaping the consequences of that decision. So Sarah saw Ishmael. She saw him with her own eyes. It wasn't discernment. She saw it. The son of Abraham had an Egyptian servant Hagar making fun of her son Isaac. They were mocking him. They were scoffing at him. They were ridiculing him. It was a form of rejection. There was jealousy there that was taking place in their household. And it had probably been going on. And it was the last straw that broke the camel's back for Sarah. So what does Sarah do? So she turned to Abraham and demanded, get rid of that slave woman and her son. Wow. He is not going to share the inheritance with my son Isaac. I won't have it. Get rid of Ishmael, she says. Can you imagine her telling her husband to get rid of a son that he had formed a bond with for that many years? When Abraham heard this, he was probably taken back. And I'm sure he was thinking, I'm not getting rid of my son. Can you imagine somebody tell you get rid of your son because he's causing too much trouble? But there was something more going on here than just an average little petty fight in the family. Amen? Amen. There was something already being birthed in Ishmael. A rejection. Isaac represents the promise. He represents the new nature. Ishmael represents the old nature. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Represents those who mock, those who reject Christ. Isaac represents ones who receive Christ. Represents the spirit, grace, salvation. Under Sarah, under the two covenants of Sarah and Hagar. So there was much more going on, and God saw that there was going to be a big problem. So she turned to Abraham and demanded, get rid of that slave woman. Get rid of that sin. Get rid of that flesh. Get rid of that flesh. The Lord is speaking. Get rid of that flesh. Get rid of that sin.
Come on.
It goes on to say, and her son. Anything that's causing interruption in your life, anything that's trying to come from the outside and cause temptation, that's kind of trying to lure you away, trying to create stumbling blocks for you, the Lord said, put it out, get rid of it.
Amen.
He's not going to share the inheritance with my son Isaac. I won't have it. Sarah had had enough. She was putting her foot down. How many know that God will send a helpmate for a husband? Because women can see things sometimes that men can't.
That's it. Come on now.
I guess it's because we're, you know, we're the ones that bear children, the women. So there's a certain discernment that's going to be a little bit different than the one the man has.
Amen.
Even as Christians. When a woman is sent to a man, that he who finds a wife findeth a good thing. Amen. He's blessed. And he obtaineth favor from the Lord. Hallelujah. That woman is a watchman on the watchtower. She will cry, wolf! The wolf is coming. She'll sound the alarm. She says, no. Pastor, my husband, he always praises me. I don't praise myself too much, but he'll praise me and say, my wife, thank God for her, because she will warn me ahead of time.
Yeah.
And sometimes he goes, in the beginning, I didn't know to listen to her, because I thought, well, no, I'm the priest of the house. You listen to me. God speaks to the priest of the house, and I'm the one that has to put things in order. But my husband learned along the way that I was a good helpmate, that I heard from the Lord. I was hearing from the Holy Spirit concerning many different things that God was trying to spare us from.
Amen.
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 Sarah is trying to spare their family a lot of grief. So she said, get rid of that slave woman and her son. He's not going to share the inheritance with my son Isaac. I won't have it. Those who don't receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will not share in eternal heaven with the rest of the saints. Those who reject the Holy Spirit, those who attribute the things of the Holy Spirit to the devil, it's called blasphemy, and will not be forgiven in this world nor the world to come.
That's right.
There was a mocking and a scoffing going on between Ishmael against Isaac, a little boy, already attacking this little blessed boy. That's what's happening today. You know, Isaac birthed the Jewish nation, and through Ishmael came the Arab nation. You know that the Arabs are the ones, well, we know what's going on. What is that? We're still reaping the consequences today of what Abraham and Sarah did thousands of years ago. Amen?
Right. Amen.
Arabs can't stand Israel, and they can't stand America because we're friends with Israel.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
We are still having that conflict today because of what happened way back in Genesis chapter 21, thousands of years ago. We are, those who don't receive Jesus Christ are being held for a point of time. It's called the wicked dead are going to be judged. The final judgment. Amen. The throne, the white throne judgment, the great white throne judgment is what it's called.
Right.
And the wicked dead are held for that appointed time to be judged. They're not going to share any inheritance.
No.
They're not going to rule and reign with Jesus Christ like we are. Amen. In the eternal.
Come on, man. That's good.
I don't know about you, but that's enough reason for me to get saved today. Amen. The Bible says today is the day of salvation.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Verse 11. This upset Abraham very much. It would upset any parent. I mean, Abraham was not God. He wasn't a spirit. He was flesh and blood, just like you and me. And here his son was with him 17 years or some odd years, and he has to send him on his way.
Wow.
So this upset him. It hurt him. It grieved him probably very much, because Ishmael was his son too. Verse 12. But God told Abraham, don't be upset over the boy and your servant. Do whatever Sarah tells you. Do whatever Sarah tells you. Are you kidding me? Do whatever the woman tells me. No, I'm in charge here. No, do what. This is what God had to tell Abraham. Abraham had to make sure that this was what she was saying was not out of anger. Was that from God? Or was that, or my wife just angry because they're having a spat or there's something going on here? So Abraham had to make sure, and God knew that Abraham had to hear from him. So he says, but God told Abraham, yeah, to speak to him. Don't be upset over the boy and your servant. He had to reassure him. How many know sometimes we need God to reassure us?
Amen.
Even though he gives us an answer sometimes, it's like, Lord, did you really mean that? Lord, did you really say you were going to do that? We need to be reassured. Why? Because we live in these bodies still.
Amen.
We haven't put on incorruptible yet. We're still wearing corruptible. But our spirit man is saved. The flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Amen.
Amen.
So this upset Abraham very much, because Ishmael was a son. But God told Abraham, don't be upset over the boy and your servant. Do whatever Sarah tells you, for Isaac is the son through whom your descendants will be counted, the Jewish nation. Verse 13, but I will also make a nation of descendants of Hagar's son, because he is your son too. I'm going to bless Ishmael as well as Isaac, but I'm going to bless him because he's your son. didn't really say, he didn't say, I'm going to bless him just the way I'm going to bless Isaac. He's going to bless him because it's Abraham's son. He's doing it because of Abraham and his prayers. Amen? And it'll be up to Hagar and Ishmael to follow through with how God is going to bless them. And we're going to see, and of course we already know the outcome of that. But it's up to them. How many know it's a choice today that we're given to follow God or not? We choose life or we can choose death. We can choose heaven or we can choose hell. They're going to have a choice to make. And I guarantee you, we know the outcome because we already know how we're living in these last days. They're not going to make the right choice. And they're going to go down the wrong path. Thus, and then henceforth, the Arab nation comes out of Ishmael's loins. And they're still giving us grief today. Amen. The mocking, the scoffing. Abraham's going to have to trust God. Sarah is going to have to trust God because Abraham is fixing to have to put out his own flesh and blood because he's mocking and scoffing and coming against the things of God. Hallelujah. There have been many times in my Christian walk where I had to put people out of my life because of the rejection of the word, the rejection of Jesus, the rejection of even trying to follow Jesus. Over the last 14 years, I've had to do that. I've lost many friends.
That's right.
But though none go with me,
amen,
I'm still going to follow.
Hallelujah.
Abraham's attitude is going to be, though none go with us, we're still going to follow. Hallelujah. Even to the point of putting out his own son. Amen. Amen. Will you trust him? Will you trust him to do what he said he's going to do? Will you trust him with that friend that you've been praying for? And I don't know why I keep praying for that friend, Lord, but I still have that burden in me to keep praying for that friend. I don't know why I keep praying for that family member, but I don't know why it won't leave me, but I have a burden to intercede and pray for that family member. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because their soul is hanging in the balance. Their soul is hanging in the balance. Lord, I don't know why, but I still don't want to stop praying and interceding for people that I care about. Hallelujah. Don't give up on your prayers. Though it tarry the vision, it will surely come to pass. Will you trust him? Will you trust him? Close your Bible.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing, but am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I this blessed assurance.